Welcome to the online conference in the radiance of the Vilna Gaon, History of Lithuanian Jewry. My name is Artur Markowski and I'm senior historian at the Polin Museum of the History of Polish Jews. And it is my great pleasure to be a chair of the opening session. I would like to welcome Mr. Mindaugas Kvietkauskas, acting Minister of Culture of the Republic of Lithuania. As I saw, Minister Kvietkauskas has joined us. Also, I would like to welcome Ms. Rasa Rimickaite, the cultural attaché of the Embassy of the Republic of Lithuania to the Republic of Poland. She's here, yeah. It is my great pleasure to see here also Professor Jurgita Verbickiene from Vilnius University. Hello, Jurgita. I'm very happy that Dr. Michał Trębacz, the head of the research department of the Polin Museum, has joined us. Hello, Michał. Also, I'm very pleased to welcome Dr. Lara Lempertiene from Martynas Mežvydas National Library of the Lithuania, who is the keynote speaker at this conference. Hello, Lara. Welcome to all panelists and guests who has joined us and would like to take part in this conference. The common history of Poland and Lithuania, which once formed the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, is a wonderful and unique part of the European heritage. This common history has also involved the Jewish community that lived on the territory of the Commonwealth. This conference is connected with the year of Vilna Gaon and outstanding, recognizable and important figure for the history, culture and religiosity of the Jews living in the Lithuania, but also the crown. We will listen to many presentations on the Vilna Gaon times today. I hope that the history of Lithuanian Jews, who were one more component of the great Polish-Lithuanian state in pre-modern times, and their fate in 19th and 20th centuries will be the subject of lively and fruitful discussions. The conference has been organized by Polin Museum of the History of Polish Jews, Embassy of the Republic of Lithuania to the Republic of Poland, and Vilnius University in partnership of Lithuanian Culture Institute. The conference is supported by the Global Education Outreach Program.
Dear speakers and participants of the conference, ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to welcome you all on the occasion of this international online conference in the radiance of the Vilna Gaon, History of Lithuanian Jewry, held on the occasion of the 300 years anniversary of Vilna Gaon. The Lithuanian Parliament has proclaimed 2020 the year of Vilna Gaon and the history of the Jews of Lithuania. This gives us a unique opportunity to rethink and reevaluate the importance of Vilna Gaon and Litvak culture, not only regionally, but also in a global context. Vilna Gaon's commentaries on the Torah and Talmud, published posthumously by his disciples, made the Gaon one of the most revered Jewish scholars. His significance to both Lithuanians and the world's Jewish culture remain unquestionable. Gaon's manuscripts are included in UNESCO's Memory of the World Register. As a researcher and translator of Yiddish literature, I may confirm that interest towards the Jewish culture and heritage has expanded significantly during the past years in Lithuania. The public discourse related to this topic has become broader and more evocative than ever before. I am convinced that events related to the year of the Vilna Gaon have also significantly broadened our perception and our historical awareness. Last month, Martynas Mažvydas National Library of Lithuania launched an amazing exhibition, Shenot Aliyahu, The Impact of the Vilna Gaon on the Lithuanian Jewish Culture, curated by Dr. Lara Lempertiene, as a culmination of a year of a Vilna Gaon. Pinkas of a Vilna Gaon synagogue is fundamental and unique showpiece of this exhibition. It is preserved at the YIVO Institute of Jewish Research in New York and is exhibited in Vilnius using hologramic projection. The visitors of the National Library can now thoroughly examine this key document related to the history of the Jewish community of Vilnius. Due to COVID pandemic, many events aimed at presenting the Litvak culture were transformed into new forms and took place mostly online, like this conference. Scientific papers, books, catalogs, exhibitions, broadcasts, concerts, documentaries, and Jewish heritage restoration projects speak for themselves. It is my honor that the Ministry of Culture of the Republic of Lithuania was partner and sponsor of many initiatives held this year. I would like to thank the organizers and partners of this conference, Poland Museum of the History of Polish Jews. Drodzy koledzy z Muzeum Polin w Warszawie, serdecznie dziękuję za wspaniałą współpracę. Also our Lithuanian Embassy to the Republic of Poland, our amazing cultural attaché in Warsaw, Rasery Mickiewicz, and Vilnius University. I wish you all profound discussions following the intellectual tradition of a Vilna Gaon.
This year we are marking 28 years of diplomatic relations between Israel and Lithuania. I'm at Judaic Research Center of our National Library. Here we're commemorating also other jubilees. And this year is also year of Gaon. So we remember our history, our dramatic, tragic pages, and also we're looking ahead to create our common future from darkness to the light. And now our Jewish community is not so big but vibrant, and we are looking ahead at not forgetting and not forgiving what has happened. We believe that we really can create new Northern Jerusalem. So Vilnius, Jerusalem Delita, Northern Jerusalem again will be center of gravity, center of attraction for Jews around the globe, for all people who are interested in Judaism and Jewish history. I'm really happy that Vilnius is the center of that. So celebrating 28 years of our relations, we're looking ahead with optimism, with creative minds, and definitely with understanding between our nations, between our people.
Dear friends, I'm very happy to greet you during the conference in the radiance of the Vilna Gaon, History of Lithuanian Jewry. Each Jew in Poland and Lithuania knows that the history of Lithuanian Jewry is related very much to the history of Polish Jewry. As you know, we were the biggest, we Lithuanian and Polish Jewry were the biggest community in Europe. We have a lot what to remember together. But Gaon Mivilna is one of the most important person in our Jewish history. A lot of people would like to be successors of Gaon, and a lot of people, very important people who are coming to visit Lithuania, Vilnius, synagogue, all of them are trying to find any relationship to Gaon. And it's okay, maybe Gaon have had so many successors, so we will have a lot of very clever, very educated people who spread all around the world. I wish your conference to be successful. I can see that a lot of very prominent specialist will give speeches today during the conference, so I wish you all the best and best regards from the Jewish community of Lithuania. Thank you.
I would like to welcome you today to today's conference, and I must say that I'm very pleased that the Polin Museum could take part in such an important event. Important not only for the Lithuanian side, but also for the Polish side. We found ourselves in a great company next to the Vilnius University, Lithuanian Cultural Institute, and the Lithuanian Embassy. I'm also extremely happy that we are taking up a topic that is relatively rarely presented during the conferences. The figure of Eliasz ben Salomon Zalman, the Vilna Gaon, is one of the figures presented at the core exhibition of the Polin Museum, and I deeply regret that we cannot invite you to visit the core exhibition, but at the same time I understand that transferring this conference online, not organizing it in the building of the museum, gave us the chance to gather more people, and I'm very pleased to hear that there are so many participants of the conference. And as I said, the Vilna Gaon is one of the figures presented at the core exhibition, and his influence on the development of the modern Judaism cannot be overestimated. Gaon is one of the greatest and most interesting figures in the history, not only of the Lithuanian, but in the history of Jews in general. He had a decisive influence on the formation of Mizrahism and Orthodox Judaism. And to end my short welcome speech, I would like to quote or change the quotation of Professor Yaakov Goldberg, who was a historian of the Jewish community of the modern times, who said that there is no history of Poland without the history of Jews, and there is no history of Jews without the history of Poland. And I think that he wouldn't mind if I would change his statement and said that there is no history of Poland without the history of Lithuania, and there is no history of Lithuania without the history of Poland. I would like to wish you all a successful deliberations during the conference. Thank you very much.
Dear Mr. Minister, dear co-organizers and participants of the International Online Conference in the Radiance of Vilna Gaon, the History of Lithuanian Jewry. It is my great pleasure to say a few remarks at the opening of this very important conference about a significant part of the Lithuanian history and culture. I am very happy that together with our partners, the Polin Museum in Warsaw and the Vilnius University, we managed to organize this conference in these turbulent times. The Jewish history in Lithuania seeks as far as the 14th century, when after the baptism of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, three non-Christian communities, Jews, Tatars and Karaites, began to settle in the territory of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. The legal and social status of Jewish community was legitimized in the first privilege for the Jews granted in Brest-Litovsk in 1388 by the Grand Duke Vytautas the Great. This privilege adapted Western variations of the Jewish law to Lithuanian realities and introduced local improvements, which started the process of the formation of the legal and social status of Jews in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. Our today's conference, its main part is to highlight the extraordinary personality of Vilna Gaon as we celebrate the 30th anniversary of the birth of Eliasz ben Salomon Zalman, outstanding Jewish scholar known as Vilna Gaon. We turn back to his historical figure, representing both the vitality and unique nature of the Litvak Judaism tradition. The legacy of Lithuania's great rabbi remains very relevant in today's ever-changing world, as it was back then in the 18th century. Thanks to him, Jews began and continue to come to Vilnius from various parts of the world, exploring his scientific heritage. The multicultural heritage of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania and of the interwar independent Republic of Lithuania stands out as an inspiration for the country's current dedication to foster its relations with all the minorities in Lithuania. The wider knowledge about the Litvak culture significantly helps to understand irreplaceable loss for Lithuania and the tragedy of the Lithuanian Jews who perished in the nightmare of the Holocaust in Lithuania during the Second World War. The year of the Vilna Gaon and of the history of the Jews of Lithuania is yet another step on our long road to find out what unites the Lithuanian and Jewish peoples in their common history. It exemplifies Lithuania's efforts not only to bring back the element of the Litvak history into the accepted narrative of Lithuania's historical memory, but also to build a continuous dialogue between the Litvak communities around the world. I wish you a very interesting conference. All the best. Thanks a lot.
Well, thank you very much. The next part of the conference will be chaired by Professor Jurgita Verbickiene. So, Jurgita, take the floor, please.
Thank you very much, Artur. I would like to greet not only all participants and not only the very famous and interesting people who participated together with us in the conference. We have approximately 100 attendees, and I would like to send my greetings and greetings of organizing committee of the conference to the attendees, to participants of the conference from United States, from the Canada, from Lithuania, from Poland, from Israel, from Switzerland, as well some people write in the chat that we have between the participation descendants of a Vilna Gaon as well. So it's really very huge and very interesting company. I would like to introduce our keynote speakers today. And it's my big pleasure because I'm introducing not only my colleague, but first of all, introducing my friend. And Dr. Lara Lempertin is the head of the Judaica Research Center at the Documentary Heritage Department in the National Library of Lithuania and the curator of its Judaica collection. Her field of expertise is the cultural history of the European and Lithuanian Jewry. She is an author of numerous articles and editors of several books. And of course, Lara is author, co-author, and conception author of the different exhibitions dedicated to the Jewish culture. And as well, Lara now have a new position as a movie star. And Lara work as well with the consulting of the different movies and films, documentary films, which was prepared during this year. We have really quite big number of different activities on national TV, on the national radio, presenting the Vilna Gaon, Vilna Gaon legacy, and Jewish life in the Lithuania. So today the presentation of Lara is the years of Elia, Vilnius with and without Vilna Gaon. Lara, floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Jurgita, for that presentation. And first of all, thanks for the invitation to that very important conference, which makes a very needed academic accent during the celebrations of that year. You know, the first sentence of my paper here is what I wrote to myself, thanks and tremors, because it's really a huge privilege and a very important task to open such really such interesting and such important event. And also it is very big pleasure, although virtually, to be in the Pauline Museum again. For me, there is a big responsibility as well to represent the National Library of Lithuania and its Judaica collection, and this will partly participate also in my talk. I would like, of course, to invite all of you to the current exhibition dedicated to Vilna Gaon, and just at any time when it will be possible, I promise every one of you could have such an individual tour of our documents connected to Vilna Gaon as the possibility will allow for. And now to my written text. Elijah ben Salomon Zalman, Eliyahu ben Shlomo Zalman, the Gaon of Vilna or Agra, has been universally acclaimed as a pinnacle of Lithuanian Jewish scholarship. The Jan's epitaph on his gravestone at the Vilna Jewish Old Jewish Cemetery, preserved in his current burial place, states this even more eloquently, and I quote, "The mysteries of the Bible, the Talmud, the Kabbalah, and all the sacred books were clear to you, as if you had received this all directly from our ancient sages," I mean, Tanaim and Amoraim. "The unrivaled researcher of the Bible, the Mishnah, both Talmuds, all collections of religious law, the Kabbalah books, and the actual names of the classical texts are mentioned here, and creator of their corrected versions. Neither major nor minor problems of the sacred texts did he ever left unsolved until the texts became as if they were just being received on Mount Sinai. There were virtually no direct contacts between the Gaon Elijah and the community, and he didn't deliver any example, be it in teaching or behavior, perceptible to many. Famously reclusive, he never formally taught in a yeshiva or established his own, and studied with a small circle of devoted disciples. He was even not interested during his lifetime to spread his teaching through publications. Even popular legends originated in the 19th century, so-called biographies of the Gaon, even those legends underline the rareness of occasions when one could actually have encountered the Vilna Gaon. One such legend is about his brilliant sermon in the Great Synagogue of Vilnius in the age of 3 or 6, depending on the version of the legend, and another of a miraculous rescue of the community during the Polish uprising, when the Gaon's recitation of a psalm in the same Great Synagogue stopped a Russian cannonball from exploding. That means, rather strikingly, twice during his lifetime. Anyone could see him, actually. It seems that in the Gaon's Vilnius, everybody knew about him, but virtually nobody knew him. Of course, in a later period, one could claim knowledge of the Vilna Gaon's teaching drawn from his published works that appeared beginning from 1799, some quite regularly. For instance, 2 commentaries to the Mishnah, Shnot Eliyahu, Elijah's Years, and Sefer Eliyahu Rabbah, the Great Book of Elijah, that were always printed by their own publishers in Vilnius, alongside, respectfully, Zeraim and Tarot divisions of the Mishnah. And obviously, the celebrated Vilna Shas, the full edition of the Babylonian Talmud, published by the Roms in 1860-1880, that included glosses by the Vilna Gaon, was a great source of his insights. Gaon's works, carefully prepared by editors, many of whom were his sons and students, included also commentaries on the Gaon's texts. It was really the best way to finally get in touch with an intellectual legacy of that revered sage. Even in popular imagination, the Gaon's expertise was unsurpassed. As renowned Vilnius librarian and Kulturträger Heiko Lunsky has written in his 1920 article, and I quote, "By a single short note, he overthrew a whole mountain of barren pilpul sophistication." But the scope of that expertise was really known to few. Haiman Voloshin was also responsible for establishing the yeshiva that he hoped to base on the Gaon's method of Torah study and to educate young Talmidei Chachamim in the intellectual and moral spirit of the Gaon. As one can see, the use of the Gaon's name here is rather emblematic. It functions in a way as a seal on the letter, giving it more weight. This was the image that was formed as early as the Gaon's death and preserved in time without much change as an essential part of Vilna Jewish Hall of Fame. Zalman Schnell, who stayed in Vilnius in 1904-1906, of course, I'm speaking of the great Hebrew and Yiddish poet, and anthologized his impressions of the city in his poem Vilna, written in 1917 and published in 1919, gave a vivid testimony of just how known the visage of the Gaon was to Vilna Jews. And I quote, a portrait of the Vilna Gaon, benevolently welcomes guests in every Jewish home. For the future years, this image had been cemented in communal consciousness to the extent that the Gaon Elijah became kind of a patron of the Vilna Jews, without direct correlation to their proficiency in classical Jewish texts or even their religiosity. As Justin Kami put it, in an interwar period, a Vilna Jew had, and I quote, a sense of civic pride and ownership over a traditional past in which the Gaon could be claimed as a folk hero even by secular Jews, end of quote. This was demonstrated when Vilna celebrated the Vilna Gaon's 200th birth anniversary in 1920. The commemorating of the Gaon's 200th birth anniversary was also a first attempt to include the Gaon into general, not only Jewish, Vilnius cityscape, by the proposal of the Jewish community to the municipality to rename one of the streets near the Schulhof, the synagogue's courtyard, for the Gaon. And it was indeed implemented, although not without hesitation from the part of the city council. The Gaon was included in the Vilna Jewish historiography tradition, beginning from its formative text, Kiryat Ne'amanah, the Faithful City, by Shmuel Yosef Fin. His work was continued by his aide, Hillel Noach Magidstein Schneider, in the latter's monograph, Ir Vilna, the City of Vilnius. In 1935, a Jewish author with an academic training, a master's degree from the Vilnius University, the later famous historian Israel Klausner, published a small monograph, The History of the Old Jewish Cemetery, to which he added a plan of the Shnipishke Cemetery, the burial place of the Vilna Gaon. And in 1938, he published a big monograph, The History of Vilna Jewish Community, the first part, the second never appeared. And in 1942, Klausner published in Jerusalem a continuation of his research with even more focus on the Gaon, as the name of his monograph, Vilna and the, in the Time of the Gaon, suggests. Of course, in Vilnius itself, at that time, the perpetuation of the Gaon's name was not possible, or so it may seem. In reality, there is at least two instances of his direct or indirect commemoration in the Vilna Ghetto. First is the description of Vilnius Jewish cemeteries made on request of the Einsatzstab Rosenberg with addition of about 20 epitaphs. It is a typescript in German, penned by Obereinsatzführer Wilhelm Schaefer, in which he mentions the aid of the locals. Last year, the original manuscript register of the epitaphs from Shnipiške Cemetery was found in the National Library of Lithuania. It is obviously a preparatory material for that Schaefer's work. It is written in different hands. The epitaph of the Gaon Elijah is copied by Heiko Lunsky, the pre-war champion of the Gaon's fame. The second instance of the Vilna Ghetto connection to the name of the Gaon is the fate of the Pinkas, or minute book of the Gaon's Cloys, or synagogue, that was a part of the Vilna Schulhof and in itself constituted a memorial to the Gaon being erected after his death. During the Nazi ordered sorting of the plundered Jewish documents in the ghetto, the poet Avrom Sutskever hid the Pinkas that before the war belonged to the archival collections of the Yivo Institute. And after the liberation of Vilnius, he was able to retrieve it. Upon leaving Vilnius in 1947, he smuggled it and returned to Yivo, now in New York, of course. The story of the rescue is laconically inscribed by him on the blank page of the Pinkas, and in detail described in David Fishman's acclaimed monograph, The Book Smugglers, published in 2017. Almost full annihilation of Lithuanian Jewish community by the Nazis and anti-religious policies of the Soviets, who again ruled Lithuania after the Second World War, left Vilnius with a very small Jewish community, one acting synagogue and one acting cemetery. In the 50s, when this Šnipiške cemetery was being destroyed, they asked the permission to transfer the remains of the Vilna Gaon and his family, as well as a few others, to the Acton Cemetery. The Gaon's name, or rather the reverence with which it was treated, made an impression, and the permission was given. In 1944, the Jewish Museum was established in Vilnius. Its staff frantically searched the ghetto territory and the whole city for Jewish documents and artifacts, those that were hidden during the Nazi occupation and those that were just scattered through the city without owners. After all, the looting and ruining, it was still an impressive amount of cultural treasures. The surviving books of the Vilna Gaon, many Talmuds and parts of the library of the Gaon's Cloys among them. However, in Lithuania, as in the whole Soviet Union, the regime implemented unofficial but very obvious anti-Semitic politics. In 1949, the Jewish Museum was closed and its exhibits dispersed among different cultural institutions. The institution called then the State Book Chamber, whose head was Antanas Ulpis, received most of the books and documents collected by the Jewish Museum. Only in the end of the 1980s, a small group of people with knowledge of Jewish languages acquired in a course of their pre-war Jewish education was officially invited by the next director of the book chamber for processing of the books and periodicals. Later, the book chamber was integrated into the National Library of Lithuania. The work of the group was led by Esther Bramson. Already in 1997, when the massive commemoration of the 200th Yahrzeit, or death anniversary of the Vilna Gaon, happened in independent Vilnius, the library was able already to present to the numerous international audience the exhibition of about 50 works of the Vilna Gaon called The Precious Legacy. This celebration that included also an international scholarly conference, several publications, proper burial of damaged Torah scrolls, and returning the Gaon's name to the street that had it in the interwar period, was a beginning of the Vilna Gaon's comeback to his city. And although even after the celebration and the veritable avalanche of information that reached the Lithuanian society in this year of the 300th Yahrzeit of the Vilna Gaon, we cannot pretend, both anniversary of the Vilna Gaon, we cannot pretend to know him really well. At least he once again became a household name in Vilnius, and this time not only for its Jewish community. Thank you. Just like to use that opportunity to introduce the author of that animation, because she's my colleague at the National Library and a brilliant comic novel author, Migla Anushauskaitė. And this short animation was prepared on the day of the Gaon's birth, 23 of April this year. So it was a real pleasure to see it at this conference.
So welcome back. And we start the second session of the second panel of our conference. And this panel is named Lithuanian Jews in the Days of the Vilna Gaon. And my name is Vladimir Levin, and I will chair this session. So our first speaker is Anna Michalowska-Mitselska, and she deals with history of Jews in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in the 16th and 18th century, especially with institutions of Jewish self-government and Jewish-Christian relations. Her postdoctoral work, Habilitatsiya, was devoted to the Lithuanian Vaad. And currently, Professor Michalowska working on a book on Jewish charity. She is the head of Mordechai Nilevich Center at the Faculty of History in the University of Warsaw. So please, Professor Michalowska, the screen is yours.
My paper discussed the functioning of Jewish Lithuania as a separate country. I put in the title, at first I put the word province, but after rethinking the terms, I decided to change it into country. When thinking about terminology, I decided that the word country will be most adequate. It is used in the Jewish sources, Hebrew word Medina, and reflects a sort of sovereignty within Jewish structures. Whereas the term province refers to a specific fragment of the whole, much less separate and independent. It would be more adequate to label as provinces the individual components of the Jewish crown, such as Wielkopolska, Great Poland, Little Poland, it is Małopolska, or Ruthenia, which, despite the individual specificity, were subordinated to Jewish principal institution, I mean Council of the Four Lands. The first reason why it is possible to speak about Jewish Lithuania as a separate country is its objective legal and political distinctness reflected by the law and jurisdiction, as well as the institutions of self-government. The second, and for me the most important or interesting factor, and the much more subjective reason, is the sense of distinctness of and own identity of the Lithuanian Jews. These two factors are supplemented by the number of elements which account on the specificity of the society of the Lithuanian Jews, contributing to their sense of distinctness without prejudging it, however. They include the nature of settlement, vocational structure, spirituality, culture, and language of Lithuanian Jews. The Jews of the Crown and the Grand Duchy of Lithuania enjoyed a different legal status. In the case of the Lithuanian Jews, it was determined by the privileges they had been granted by the Grand Dukes and the provisions of successive Lithuanian statutes, 1529 and then 1566 and 1588, which later became a point of reference for the legislation adapted by the Noble Diet. What made Jewish Lithuania distinct, however, was its own central self-government institution, the Council of Lithuanian Jews, it is Lithuanian Vaad. In 1623, the Lithuanian Jews separated from the Jewish Council and established their own central organization equal to the Council of Four Lands, which since then began to operate only in the Crown. The breakup is said to have taken place in 1623, when the first records had been entered in the Pinkas of the Lithuanian Vaad. No Jewish sources offer the reasons why the Lithuanian Vaad went independent, and one may only guess that the breakup was due to the legal, administrative, and taxation duality in the Crown and Lithuania. It seems that the taxation duality in particular was decisive because Lithuanian Jews had to pay a poll tax passed by the Commonwealth Diets, independently from the Crown and Lithuania, to the treasury, Lithuanian treasury, and they were under the jurisdiction of the Lithuanian treasurer. Any tax disputes were settled by the fiscal tribunal operating independently in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. Although over 17th century, the poll tax, the system of the poll tax collection from the Lithuanian Jews was subject to change. It was always closely connected with the institutions of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. It is also likely that the reason why the Lithuanian Vat became independent were the conflicts between the Crown and Lithuanian Jewish communities living along the border over the jurisdiction over the surrounding areas. Involved in such disputes for many years were Grodno and Tykocin communities, for example. And the main reason behind the institution of the Lithuanian Vat was to create a structure able to operate in the entire country. In order to take steps for the benefit of the old Jews in at the royal court during the meetings of the noble diet and dietines in non-Jewish tribunals and courts, it was necessary to act on a large scale and to have sizable funds, and only the central institution could command such amounts. The Vat's decisions applied to all Lithuanian Jews, and also the steps it would take were to guarantee the safety and favorable living conditions to the Jews of the entire Lithuanian country. Whenever the state threatened to deprive the Jews of their rights and prospects for business, completely or partly, the VAT would act very quickly and efficiently. One may also observe a number of preventive measures aimed at eliminating conflicts and tensions with Christian surroundings. Prevalent among the Vat's elite was the thinking in terms of the well-being of all Lithuanian Jews. Only should a major risk arise, the Lithuanian interest would give way to overall Jewish interest. It is evident that the Jews of Eastern Europe, even through living in a broad Ashkenazic area, identified themselves with smaller areas or countries, of countries and provinces. The perception of the distinct nature and specificity of individual regions and the phenomenon of identification not only with one specific community, but with a larger area is interesting, especially that we deal with a society which is very mobile. In Lithuania, the situation was simple in that we deal with independent structures of the state and along with them, with the independent Jewish structures. Other provinces were marked by a less clear-cut situation, which calls for the further studies. Thank you very much.
So our next speaker is my old friend, Jurgita Verbickienė. Jurgita is a professor of history at the Faculty of History at the Vilnius University, and she is also the head of the Center for Studies of History of East European Jews in Vilnius. Her major field of research and teaching is the socio-cultural history of Jews and other non-Christian groups in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, interwar Lithuania, and Eastern Europe in general. And now she is leading a long-term initiative of the Vilnius University, which is named Recovering Memory, and its aim is to commemorate and pay respect to members of Vilnius University community, both staff and students, who were expelled from the university, losing the ability to continue their academic careers or studies because of the actions of the totalitarian regimes and their local collaborators. So Jurgita will speak. The topic, title of her paper is Vilnius Jewish Community in the Times of the Vilna Gaon, People, Families, and the Patterns of Everyday Life. Jurga, please, the microphone and the screen are yours.
Thank you, Valoda, for the kind introduction. The Vilna Gaon is one of the historical personalities who add even more color to the exceptional face of Vilnius. Even though in some instances its folk legends which do not tell us much about the man himself, Rabbi Eliyahu ben Shlomo Zalman. A lot of research has been done about the Vilna Gaon, but the object of my talk today is not him. Rather, it is about the social environment in which the Rabbi Eliyahu was understood and recognized. The 18th century Vilnius Jewish community, his neighbors, whose he would meet in the Vilnius Jewish quarter if he went out for a walk. I would like to ask a few questions and try to find answers for him. What was the social and political life like in the Jewish community? What was the size of the Vilnius Jewish community? How many people in the community by their education or professional activities would have been able to understand his Jewish world genius? All these questions come together into one general, simple question, which I think has not been asked before. Who the neighbors of the Vilna Gaon? During the 1764 census, together with other Jews in the territory of the former Jewish quarter, there was an entry market Elias Zelmanovich, head of a family living together with him and making up one household there. And now I quote, wife Hannah, son Zelman, daughter Basa, servant Nahama, end of quotation. I would like to note that there was no professional listed for the Eliyahu, like for many of Jews that they accounted. The house of his part of Vilnius were no higher than two stories, but we do not know if households were listed from the first floor to the second or from the second floor to the first. The Gaon family closest neighbors were grave digger Kopach Mogilny, Josel Mojashovich and his wife Slova, and their son Misel with his wife, and all listed as part of the same household. The two families comprising the household declared as many as four children under the age of one. The door of Eliyahu's apartment was next to another neighbor, the furrier Kushniash Josel Aronovich and his family. This household consisted not only of parents and their married sons, but also their married daughters' families. Other neighbors, they also ordinary Jews of the middle of the or even lower social classes. One family supplemented their incomes by sublenting part of their apartments to the lodgers. The family of our Fourier and the family of the apparently younger family with two children also lived in the same building. Sometime before the 1784, the Vilna Gaon had already buried his wife Hannah and married a second time. At the time, beside himself and his second wife Gitel, the household of Elias Zelmanovich included daughter Hannah and eldest son Zelman with his wife Rocha and their daughter Treina. The Gaon moved from these former residence on Voketu, German Street, and I quote, to the left side descending from the German of Jewish Street. If you see my cursor, it's this one building there Eliyahu lived, and then it goes to another this one big building, and Gaon Klois is this one number seven. It was a huge tenement building with an interior courtyard next to the Great Synagogue of Vilnius, but a bit far from the so-called Gaon Klois than his previous residence. This time, the Gaon's apartment was one of 32 in the building. The number of residents was 169, of whom 45 were lodgers. Some renters lived together with two or even three lodger families, and 13 their servants. In this census, to the Gaon's family is not enumerated any differently from anyone else, and his occupation is not noted. By the professions of the Gaon's neighbors, in whose case their professional is identified, included many typical Jewish economic and crafts activities of that time. It can be said that the Gaon and his family could avail themselves of all necessary services without ever leaving their courtyard. Their neighbors included a baker, fisherman, seven tailors, seven furriers, two teachers, bakalash, even the families of musician Yosel, water carrier Laser, and three butchers. Eliyahu Vilna lived in the livest section of the Jewish quarter, next to the Great Synagogue, which according to the legend he visited but rarely, and next to the butcher shops. at least more than 160 neighbors, unproposingly in appearance and modus in this his lifestyle, as he must have appeared to numerous people at the time. He has nevertheless extraordinary in this achievements and his genius and Vinza. Legends were necessary to keep the Vilna Gaon in popular memory, to create an extraordinary context for his activities and his legacy. It would not surprise me if the credits for encouraging and supporting the Vilna Gaon was not elaborated by the Vilnius community at the later time, as legends about the Gaon served as instruments of memory. But this seems to be the case. Their legends are more interesting, more inspiring, and more dynamic than the actual life of a Vilna Gaon in Jewish quarter tenement house. Thank you.
And our last but not least speaker is my dear teacher, Professor Shaul Stampfer of the Hebrew University. So Professor Stampfer grew up in Portland, Oregon, and went eastward to New York to Yeshiva College for his BA. And he continued in that eastern direction and completed his doctoral studies at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. And I must say that I met him first time when he continued even more to the east in to Moscow. And he taught at the Hebrew University and is now retired. His initial focus was on the history of education and the dynamics of modernization. But currently, Professor Stampfer is working on demographic and economic history of East European Jews. Professor Stampfer will speak, the title of his paper is Why There Are So Many Jews in Vilna and in Lithuania? An interesting question. Shaul, the screen is yours, please.
Thank you very much for the introduction. As you were talking, I was making calculations. I think that over the years, I've learned more from you than you learned from me. But I take that as a sign of my success, because it just shows that what a little encouragement at the beginning can do and how much you have done with that encouragement. So I find that that's a very good sign on my part. So the question that I wanted to start with was, why were there so many Jews in Vilna or Vilnius and in Lithuania? And the question, of course, has to be divided, first off, between the city and the country, and secondly, depends on the period. To prepare for this lecture, I wanted very much to go to the library and to work on some of the classic studies of Bereshadsky, which I do not have at home, but the libraries in Israel are closed. The libraries are closed, and I could not use the sources in the libraries. And working at home, I had different materials. And one of the interesting ones, which is not used very much, for good reasons, is the supplement to Pinkas HaMedina. The major source for studying the communal organization of early modern Jews in Lithuania is the Pinkas Medinat Lita, which was edited by Dubnov, and it's the basis of the classic book by Anna Michalowska, which always stays within 1 meter of my hand. It goes over my desk. And this is the basic source that we have to reconstruct communal life in the past. The one most important thing to remember about city life is that life in the city can be challenging, it can be offer opportunities for economic advancement, and it is also deadly. People who live in cities until relatively recently died much more than people who lived outside of cities. Why? Because populations that are concentrated in cities in the early modern period have problems with input and with output. What is the problem of input? The problem is food and water. The food that one gets in the city may or may not be good. It is usually brought in by wagons from the countryside, but what one has available in the city is water. And what is the problem with water? Water supplies very easily can become affected by sewage. That's the output. And this creates ideal situations for the spread of infections, which is why infectious diseases, plagues, all kinds of health problems are very, very common in cities. And this creates the situation in which in most early modern cities in Europe, the number of deaths was greater than the number of births. How then did people live in cities if they saw how dangerous it was? Because many of these deaths were among young children. People who survived childhood had better chances of survival, but the population did not grow because so many children died. And what transformed city life was improvements in sanitation, improvements in water supply, and improvements in sewage. Until that happened, cities grew in population for only because of one reason, because populations that were moving into cities, migration from rural areas to urban cities. So that the lack of growth in the urban centers is not at all impossible. Moreover, in times of war, cities are a target for fighting much more than rural areas. And here as well, the populations of cities suffered, and the conditions in Lithuanian cities, especially during the wars with Muscovy, were indeed horrendous for the urban populations. At the same time, the populations of the country as a whole could and did grow. First off, there was an anomalous situation. In many cities, restrictions were made on Jewish settlement, whereas in Vilnius, there was a quarter which the Jews were limited to that quarter to a large extent, with some exceptions. In other cities, there was a true non-tolerantes Judaeus. Jews could only live outside the cities. The Jews, of course, complained about this bitterly because they wanted to live in cities because city life is more attractive. However, by being forced out, they were forced to live in places that were healthier, that were more conducive to population growth. And indeed, the rapid population growth would seem to have taken place mainly outside of the urban centers. So if we look at the early modern period, why there were so many Jews in Vilnius is not so much of a question, because in Vilnius, there weren't so many Jews. In Lithuania, there truly were, and we have seen some of the reasons for that. There is a lot more to be studied, and maybe someday somebody will analyze in great detail the tax records, But until then, we do already have something of a clear picture of some of the demographic trends and dynamics of Lithuanian Jews. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's high time to begin the second section. Second section of our conference entitled Social and Religious Life of Lithuanian Jews. And our first speaker will be Mr. Aiveras Poška. Mr. Poška is a PhD student in history at the Lithuanian Institute of History, who specialized in legal and social aspects of Jewish history in Central and Eastern Europe during the late medieval and early modern periods. And currently he is preparing his PhD thesis entitled Jewish Communities in the Self-Governing Towns of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania during 14th to 17th centuries, legal and economic relations. Mr. Poška, the floor or the screen is yours.
So I will start with my presentation. So the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, just as well as a Polish kingdom, is often called Paradisus Judaeorum for its favorable attitudes toward the Jews, especially in the private towns owned by the noble families. Without a doubt, the nobility played an important role in the dissemination of the Jewish communities. As from the second half of the 16th century, the Jewish communities experienced extensive growth as they began to settle in the newly founded private towns. A comparison of really illegal documents that formed Jews' legal status and economic status in the towns of Biržai, Dubingiai, and Nesvyj Olyka family lines show us that the Nesvyj Olyka line adapted stricter, especially regarding the Jews' living space regulation than in the Biržai Dubingiai family line. In case of Nesvyj and presumably in Olyka, Jewish communities had clearly defined living space, and in Nesvyj case, as well as a designated number of plots to them. We can say that during this early stage of Jewish settlement in Radzivill's towns, Radzivills formed the Jews' local status mostly by applying general privileges locally and adapting the similar or the same regulation as in their rural towns. Such local Jews' status formation was probably encouraged by the Jewish settlers themselves, as they wanted to secure similar legal and economic rights as they used to have. In the first half of the 17th century, the main reason why the Jews started settling in the private towns was not the favorable legal and economic regulations, but that in smaller towns there were less economic competition and more economic niches to that Jews can occupy. It seems that the rapid growth of the Jewish communities was the main reason why in the second half of the 17th century, Jews' local status was modified, and certain restrictions on some economic activities and their living space were introduced. This correlation is extremely noticeable in Olyka, as in 1662, about 251 Jewish taxpayers lived in Olyka. Similar trends could be seen in Sletsk. In 1620s, about 13 taxpayers lived in the town, as in 1661, the number grew to 105. The main reason of such exponential growth is Jews' migration, which occurred during and after Bogdan Khmelnytsky's uprising. In conclusion, we can see that in the second half of the 17th century, the Jews, both branches of the Radzivill family, adapted restrictive policies toward the Jews, limiting their economic influence and competitiveness, and strengthening the municipal town's authority regarding the Jews that lived in self-governing part of the town, as well as raising proportions of the Jews' contributions paid to the town. However, in all towns excluding the Olyka, these restrictions had not violated economic rights of the Jews that were stated in the local and general privileges. However, various restrictions on Jewish trade regarding the time and place were introduced, just as in other royal towns. Regarding the Jewish rights to engage crafts, it seems that Birger Dubinge family line had adopted the strategy of forming multi-confessional artisan guilds. In this way, solving the disagreements between Christian and Jewish artisans. We can see that in the first half of the 18th century, there were only slight modifications regarding the Jewish legal economic status in the Rustville towns. It seems that in the beginning of the 18th century, such practice of creating multi-confessional artisan guilds was also applied in Nesvieš, as in most other Radzivill towns, Radzivill family towns. However, each Jewish community had unique rights and restrictions as well regarding their economic rights. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now I would like to greet Vladimir Levin. Professor Levin is the director of the Center of Jewish Art at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. He researches synagogues in Eastern Europe and also synagogues as social institutions. He co-edited the catalog of synagogues in Lithuania and also co-authored a book on synagogues in Volhynia. And currently he works on a book about Jewish material culture in Siberia.
Thank you very much for your introduction. Yeah, I'm just trying to arrange my screen. When I gave the title of my lecture, of my paper, and wanted to compare synagogues in Lithuania with other regions in Eastern Europe. Probably I didn't think well before proposing such a topic. And when I started to prepare this talk, I understood that first of all, I don't know what to compare with what. So we can speak, we can compare synagogues of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania with synagogues of the Polish crown, for example. But it would work only for the 17th and 18th centuries, because in 16th centuries we have no information about synagogues, almost no information. So in the 90s, when we speak about the 19th century, we should change the comparison scheme, because we should compare Lithuanian synagogues and with the synagogues in the Russian Empire, in the entire Russian Empire, and this would be another comparison. And therefore, I decided that I will concentrate. Of course, in the interwar period, we have independent Lithuanian state. Okay, I know its borders are modern and not interwar, but so with what should we compare these synagogues during this time? And should we compare synagogues in the modern Lithuanian state or in the Jewish Lithuania, which roughly coincides and Duchy of Lithuania? So since there are so many questions, I decided that I will do a comparison between two regions. Since I participated in the book on synagogues of Lithuania and in the book on synagogues in Volhynia, I will compare synagogues in those two regions, so modern Lithuania and Volhynia. What we mean by Volhynia is the province in the Russian Empire. So the first would be, of course, the synagogue, or Beit HaKnesset in Hebrew, or Shul, or Die Große Shul in Yiddish. And in here, I didn't find any differences between Lithuania and Volhynia, besides the difference in the Yiddish dialect. So while in Lithuania people say shul, in Volhynia people say, and sometimes also write shil. According to the article of Elhanan Reiner, old article of Elhanan Reiner, Kloyes was a private institution for Torah study, which was usually established by a private donor who not only arranged the space or built the building, but also provided scholarships for Torah scholars to spend all their time in the cloisters, investing their time in the study. So this is true for Lithuania and for Volhynia for the 17th and 18th century, and I'm showing you the one of the cloisters in the Vilnius Shulhov, the new cloisters, which was built by Yesod, one of the prominent Jewish leaders and very rich people in Vilna in the 18th century. So he built the building, and he also established scholarship for the people to stay in the cloister. It works like an academia. And we see that this cloister, until the late 19th century, it had no arrangements for women's participation, or women's prayer, not participation, God forbid, but women's presence during the service, and only in the late 19th century, the women's gallery was built in this building. And so this is a typical cloister, like Elkanon Reiner described it. The same should be said about the cloister of the Vilna Gaon. Although the building was erected in the mid-19th century, it was erected on the place where his cloister was situated, and we see that all arrangements here were made for the Torah study. Please pay attention to the pews, to benches for worshippers and Torah students. So it's possible to sit back to back, and everybody has the possibility to have his own standard and to put his book on it. And during the time of prayer, the Torah Ark is on our right hand. During the time of prayer, people who usually sat with their back to the Torah Ark could stand and put the books, prayer books already now, on this part of the pew. And we have photographs of people studying. This is this guy is sitting to his with his face to the Torah Ark, and these famous photographs. You see, here is the Torah Ark, and these three guys are sitting with their backs to the Ark and studying some sacred text. But in the 19th century, cloisters as a private institution, private academy, disappeared, but its name remained. And when we look at Lithuania, we'll find that every smaller prayer house is called a cloister. So we have a great cloister in Kėdainiai, we have a cloister of chimney sweepers, so it's a society. This one is probably communal, so chimney sweepers, of course, it's a cloister of association, and also private prayer houses like this one in Utena. All of them are named cloisters. So in Lithuania, almost every smaller prayer house, it would be besides the great synagogue and the Beit Midrash, communal Beit Midrash, would be called cloisters. Lithuanian Jews called Hasidic prayer houses minyan. That is a quorum of 10 people, and usually this name is applied for private prayer quorums which somebody has at home, so it's somebody's minyan. But in many places in Lithuania, we see that the name minyan is stuck to the Hasidic prayer house. And here, for instance, look at the picture on the right, it's Vilnius Shulhov. We have two similar synagogues. One is Hevra Poalim, and it's called cloisters. And the second one is a Hasidic synagogue, and it is called minyan, and in better case, shtibel, never cloisters. And the last topic for this paper is the difference between Lithuania and Volhynia would be the fate of the great synagogue. So each community, as we said in the beginning, each community had a great synagogue, this shul. And in the 19th century, we see that it's in Lithuania, but it's not used too much. And the people mostly pray in Beit Midrash, in the nearby Beit Midrash, because it's not too cold, and it's much more convenient there. And from different localities, we have texts which say that the Great Synagogue was used only during the summer or only during the holidays, or during Saturdays in summer. So the in the 19th century, at least, the usage of Great Synagogues was quite restricted. And when we see also that in many Lithuanian communities, when there is a fire and all the synagogues are burned down, the community usually in the late 19th century, early 20th century, the community usually rebuilds Beit Midrash or Batei Midrash, if there are several buildings, very quick, and it never rebuilt the Great Synagogue. And of course, I cannot show you a photograph of the building which was not rebuilt after the fire, because it disappeared. And of course, the last difference is the number. In an average Lithuanian community, we will find 3 buildings for prayer, which would be the Great Synagogue, Beit Midrash, and Klois. And in Volhynia, because of the Jewish population there is much larger, I didn't find the community which had only 3 prayer houses. Usually it is much more, something about 10 prayer houses. And this shows not only the size of the Jewish, comparative size of Jewish population in per community in Lithuania and Volhynia, but also that Volhynian Jews were relatively better than the Lithuanian Jews in the 19th and 20th century, and could allow to build also large synagogue buildings that Lithuanian Jews didn't do in small places. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Levin. And our last lecturer is Mr. Saulius Kaubris from the Vilnius University. Mr. Kaubris was graduated from Vilnius, and his doctoral dissertation was on the Lithuanian's government educational policy 1918-1940. Now he works at the Department of Contemporary History at the Vilnius University, and the main field of scientific interest is a history of national minorities and in Eastern and Central Europe.
Thank you very much for so wide introduction, and I will start now my presentation on the title, A Portrait of a Jewish Secondary School Pupil during period from 1918 to 1940. Changes in the composition of Jewish secondary schools, school students varied. For example, 1939-1940, 2,033 students, it means 845 boys and 1,188 girls, comprised approximately 40% of all students studying in private gymnasia, or 10% of all students in Lithuanian gymnasia. In other words, I would like to say every 10th gymnasium student in Lithuania was Jewish. The most students attended the Kaunas, our capitals, Lithuania's capital school's Jewish gymnasium, for example, 336, second gymnasium, 237, and some of Jewish gymnasiums were too small. For example, like in Raseini, only 79 pupils were counted in the reports of my mentioned gymnasium. The Jewish secondary schools were in effect solely Jewish. I would like to say, only Jewish students attend. On the other hand, sometimes the number of Jewish students in some schools change because of changing conditions. For example, reacting to the beginning of anti-Semitic actions in Germany in 1933, the Lithuanian Jewish community withdrew their children from German language schools. For example, in 1932, there were 116 Jewish children enrolled in the Kaunas German Gymnasium, but next year, in 1933, only three, and in 1934, there were four Jewish students. In 1932, 116, and in 1934, only four. There was a similar trend in the Shaulei German Middle School. In 1932, for example, there were 10 Jewish students and none at all in later years. There were also atypical situations when Jewish children ended up in Catholic-supported schools. For example, at the beginning of the 1938-39 school year, 30 Jewish students attended the Prienų Žiburys private gymnasium and 15 Jewish students attended the Švėkšna Saulė private gymnasium at the same time too. And an analysis of the parental professions of individual students at Jewish schools also reveals an association between the parents' financial means and the children's opportunities to pursue education. For example, in 1932-1933, when school enrollment was 147 students, the Panevėžys Jamne Jewish Girls' School records indicate that the dominant profession of parents was in commerce. In the first form of those 17 who indicated their parents' profession, 8 were tradesmen. In the second form, it was 3 out of 15. In the third, 7 of 20, in the fourth, 7 of 21, and other. I would like to say that summarizing this data, I found some very interesting statements that my father works like merchant in Africa or in Palestine at the same time. I would like to say that, in other words, approximately 39-40% of all parents were engaged, namely in commerce. Other professions are also identified in the list of parental occupations. For example, 9 students were the children of rabbis and 10 were children of civil servants. Some students who began their studies were forced to withdraw for various reasons. For example, at the Volkovichskis Jewish Gymnasium, 33 students dropped out in the 1933 school year. Reasons given included unsuccessful academic progress, 10 students, family circumstances, 2, illness, 5, other reasons, 16. In 1938, 22 students dropped out for these reasons. Illness 1, departure for the United States of America 1, transfer to other schools 6, non-payment of school fees 1, unsuccessful academic progress 2, other reasons 11. In short, the most frequent reasons given for the changed life prospects of these students was academic failure, illness, and unknown factors. In place of conclusions, shortly I would like to say that the analysis of a portrait of Jewish gymnasium student testifies on a favor of its specificity, maybe. Some features of it stipulated the main characteristics of Jewish gymnasium students in Lithuania. Usually Lithuanian Jewish schools were very closed, like I would like to say, comparing, for example, with characteristics with public, for example, organizations. Usually all Jewish organizations, public organizations were closed to very closed or closed types organizations. The contingent or national composition of Jewish schools was totally Jewish. The tuition fee was higher than in state schools. Usually in all private schools in Lithuanian or German school, tuition fees were higher than in state schools. The closing of some schools induced processes of students' so-called migration from one school to another one. Some of them opted for learning in the Lithuanian schools and by surprise in schools supported by Catholic organizations. The tradesman occupancy of parents prevailed in a list of parents' professions. Thank you very much for your attention.
Maybe I would like to go to the summarizing of the conference and at the same time invite Anna to join me for the summarizing of conference and summarizing of our activity today. And I would like to tell thank you. First of all, thank you for all of you for participating, for the questions, for the answers, for just listening and interesting in the topic. And first, I would like to thank you all organizers, Pauline Museum. I would like expect my special gratitude to the Lithuanian Embassy in Poland and Kultur Attaché, Mrs. Rasa Rimutskaite, as well my colleague and friend from the Warsaw University and from the Pauline Museum, Artur Markovsky, as well Mrs. Karolina Zagorska and Lidex Technica for the technical support of our conference. And I would like to announce that probably all of presentations from today are planned to publish in Jewish Quarterly Review. I think it will be in the next year. We try to do that as soon as possible. And it is more or less the most important technical remarks, but I would like to go to the content and to go to a summarizing of the content. And in this context, I would like to tell you one surprise, one small surprise. And it's really very interesting that this conference, when we're discussing Vilnius and Vilna Gaon legacy, it's first after quite long time. So it's really very, very specific. And if we look on the historiography, we don't have books. We don't have books about the Vilnius Jewish community at all. And we don't have books on Vilnius Jewish community in the 18th century, except the writings which was done in the 19th century on in the beginning of the 20th century. So these names of his authors was used today several times. I would like to add Ignacy Kraszewski that write generally in Vilnius about Vilnius and include Jewish topic, but this of course it's 19th century as we all of us know. Sergei Bershadsky is as well from the 19th century and trying to reconstruct the creation of the Jewish quarter in Vilnius and other important text in Jewish history in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania. Of course, we have a Jewish historiography and it was mentioned today several times, Shmuel Yosefim and Kirya Nemana, Faithful City. It is as well 19th century. Then they have Hillel Noach Magich Steinschneider, Ir Vilna. It's as well not so new book. Then they have Israel Klausner. It's Holocaust time and Israel Cohen. It's as well the Holocaust time. So it's the beginning of the 50s. So it's really a very specific situation that till now we don't have a book about the Vilnius Jewish community. So we don't have any rethinking about that. But the surprise is in that the Vilnius history is as well not well researched. And till now we don't have Vilnius history at all. So it's... I mentioned Vakrashevsky from the 19th century. We have Adolfo Šapoka, who write a series of the articles, but in emigration in Canada, and it is in the middle of the 20th century, but of course he worked without the sources or with limited limited possibility to work with archival sources, then they have during the Soviet times prepared very ideological history of Vilnius. It's long durée till the Soviet Vilnius as Soviet capital, and nothing. So it's really a very specific situation that we discussing these things, but without any. Sorry for that. It's not under my control. Just a moment. Okay, I too. Thank you. And it's nothing. Only David Frick's work, which have draw attention on the Vilna situation. Of course, it deals with the 17th century. They know that all of us, but the Jewish topic is not the main topic of David Frick. So we are in a very specific situation. And today what we do, it was really very interesting because we have a bright number of the topics. And what I'm happy on that mostly, that we try in several presentations, we go in one direction, and it was not agreement before, so we don't have any communication before about our content of our presentation, but it was very clear direction that we try to humanize the Vilna Gaon. We try to talk about him as the person, but not more as the legend. And what Shaul Stampfer mentioned, that Vilnius community is not allowed to deal with the creation of the Vilna Gaon geniality. So because he comes to Vilnius, he comes in the same way as a lot of people from the villages, from the shtetls in the Grand Duchy of Lithuania comes to capital to find a place. So as well, we have quite bright number of the topics, and I think that these direction to talk the doubt mythologization and to talk by facts and talk based on the sources about the Vilna Jewish history, about the Vilna Gaon, about the Lithuanian Jewish community spiritual and educational life. It's the main direction of today's conference, and I think that it's great deal to find new approaches to the history, which even at the moment is in the stagnation position, because I tell you what we have exactly situation, we don't have new researches.
Yeah, as Jurgita said, we are planning to publish the text in Kwartalnik Historii Żydów Polish, Jewish History Quarterly. It has a new layout and looks brand new, but this is an old periodical published from the 1950. And so well, you are all invited to produce, to prepare text for publication. And we will announce the deadline and everything by mails. So I'm very, very glad to be able to participate in the conference where the majority of the texts were devoted to the early modern period. It's a very unusual situation because normally one or two papers are devoted to the earlier epochs, and majority is devoted to Holocaust or at least late 19th century. Now we have the majority of the text connected with early modern period and with Lithuanian Jews. It's also unusual, and it shows the new trend, I think, to balance between the investigation, the research on Crown and Lithuanian Jews. And we all know that research on Lithuanian Jews are neglected, and we have no practically new research, maybe with some exceptions, but generally the research on Crown Jews is dominated the research on Lithuania.
I would like to thank all participants, especially our keynote speaker, Lara. Thank you very much, Lara, for excellent lecture. and also many thanks to all people who help us to organize this conference. As Jurgita said, I would like to mention, first of all, Rasa Rimickaite, cultural attaché of Embassy of Republic of Lithuania, and also Professor Jurgita Verbickiene, who helped us a lot to work during the organizing works. And I would like to many thank my colleague from the Poland Museum, Karolina Zagórska, who helped us a lot with administration things and who keep us together during the process of the organizing of this conference. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for all of you. It was really very nice to see you, and have a nice evening. All of us, I think, we have in the evening time. And see you next time in the next format, I think. Oh, thank you very much. Bye.
Imagine a simple 18th century building. Inside, there is an aesthetic room with a candle burning, book pages being turned, and probably a soft voice murmuring in Hebrew. The voice belongs to a man who spent almost his entire life inside these four walls, yet probably considered this a great blessing. In the street, next to his house, people would often talk about him.
Er schlaf nicht mehr wie vier Scheunen Tag.
Er stellt rein die Füße in Wasser, er soll länger kennenlernen.
Selten redet er mit dem Spoche.
Although, according to him, one should neither praise nor curse another, for the sin of the tongue is the most severe. It comes as no surprise that today no one exactly knows how the man looked like. We could presume that he simply couldn't be bothered to spend hours waiting for his portrait to be painted. Yet, his intellectual and spiritual legacy remain alive up to this day.
Žydų tauta visų pirma garsėja sukurtais tekstais, knygomis, išminčių vardais. Svarbu yra suprasti, kad tekstas yra ir pasaulio sukūrimo planas tradicinėje kultūroje, ir kartu jo vykdymo planas. Žodis gaonas reiškia išminčius arba didybę, bet didybę ne kažkokią socialinę prasme, o grinai intelektualinę prasme. Pirmųjų gaonų darbo rezultatas yra vienas didžiausių žydų religinės teisės ir paprotinės teisės savadas, kuris vadinamas Talmudu. Pavyzdžiui, šitas leidimas pats yra 1883 metų ir jau jis publikuojamas kartu su gaonų komentarais. Tai yra jau manoma tais laikais, kad be gaonų komentarų iš visų šitos vietos neįmanoma suprasti.
However, the Gaon himself never cared to publish his texts. He also neither held an official rabbinical position, nor could he be regarded as a community leader. In fact, the only official documents proving his existence are from 18th century population censuses, which indicate nothing more than his name and a surname. And yet, despite this lack of factual information, his influence is tangible for any religious Jew in the world. In this rare footage, we can see one of the many religious academies, known as yeshivas, established by Lithuanian Jews or Litvaks. Now found all across the world, these schools were first started by a small circle of Gaon's former disciples. They have not only published his texts, but also developed a unique study method based on his teachings. It involves an in-depth analysis of classic Judaic texts and a continuous 24-hour study of the Torah. Eventually, the Vilna Gaon became a multifaceted symbol. Some regard him as a genius for his analytic mind. For others, he is a religious authority who embodies the idea that studying the Torah is the holiest act of all. There are also people who see him as a mystic and an expert on the Kabbalah. We can only imagine how much these images correspond to reality, and what other qualities he possessed, especially with his reclusive way of life. Yet one thing is sure, the Gaon's example and legacy transformed the Lithuanian capital of Vilnius into an intellectual and spiritual center of Jewish culture. The local Jewish community prioritized wisdom and piety over material gain and social success. Thus, just before the Holocaust, Vilnius had 10 yeshivas, more than 100 synagogues, and was widely known as the Lithuanian Jerusalem, or the Jerusalem of the North.
Bet kuriuo atveju tai yra ganėtinai unikali knyga, nes matosi, kad jinai pilna schemų, jinai vadinasi išvertus pažodžiui, tai čia ne trikampis, o triragis elnias.
The Vilna Gaon can also be called an innovator, as he expanded his interest into other fields of study, such as Hebrew grammar, natural sciences and geometry. However, it seems that these additional interests were not for the sake of science, but yet another tool to better understand the Torah. One Talmudic Haggadah, or a story, tells of a huge frog, which is the size of 60 buildings. A snake swallows the frog, and a raven catches the snake and flies away to sit on a tree, the tree of life. A commentary on this story written by the Vilna Gaon himself may be the closest we can get to his image today. For him, the frog symbolizes a Torah scholar who is active day and night. The 60 buildings are the 60 volumes of the Talmud. The snake signifies the temptations that might prevent one from studying texts. And the raven is someone who overcomes these temptations by devoting his entire life to one single purpose.